We all know and love the Saturn V rocket, but what if it was bigger and better? Today on Vintage Space. Building the Saturn V rocket was no small feat. Individual pieces were constructed around the country and then all shipped to Kennedy Space Flight Center in Florida, where they could be mated, checked out, and then launched on a mission to the moon. By the late 1960s, there was already so much industry and infrastructure built up around the production of this vehicle that it made a lot of sense to actually continue the Saturn V program to build derivatives that could not only launch human missions to the moon, but into deep space, and even take unmanned missions to different planets. So what might some of these Saturn V derivatives have looked like? Well, there was one study done by two engineers at the Marshall Space Flight Center in 1968 that gives at least one window into the future that we might have had we continued the Saturn V program. The idea was that by using all of the facilities already in place and all the infrastructure around the Saturn V rocket, it would actually be cheaper to build these larger derivative rockets than come up with a whole new space launch system. So they looked specifically at vehicle derivatives that would use what they call a common core, basically a core stage of the rocket that could have additional pieces added to it or taken away depending on a mission's needs, such that the Saturn V would become a very modular, multi-purpose vehicle, something that could put payloads into low Earth orbit between 50,000 pounds and 500,000 pounds. The first derivative they look at is not a derivative at all. It's the core Saturn V that we know and love, only take the lunar module out of the adapter and put in a different payload. Using the volume of the LM shroud for a different payload, the Saturn V could launch interplanetary missions. There was even a different study done by Bellcom around the same time in the late 1960s that looked at replacing the lunar module with an environment module for manned flybys of Venus and Mars, albeit this was only a concept study as well. So the Saturn V derivative family was meant to address two major issues with the existing Saturn V family, which is basically the Saturn I, the Saturn I-B, and the Saturn V. The first is the massive discrepancy in lift capability between the Saturn I-B and the Saturn V. Smaller derivatives of the Saturn V could fill that gap, lifting payloads into orbit that was somewhere between the lift capabilities of these two rockets. The second shortcoming of the Saturn V program as it existed was not really a shortcoming so much as the derivatives would be used to look ahead at what the authors say was the inevitable expansion of human exploration deep into the solar system. And that means heavier payloads. The second discrepancy isn't really a discrepancy at all. The authors are simply looking ahead and realizing that Saturn V derivatives could help push and be the muscle behind the inevitable expansion of humans into deep space, with both robotic and manned missions. So here is the family of Saturn V derivatives as they are imagined in this study. Let's start at the beginning with the A derivative. The A derivative of the Saturn V is very similar to the Saturn I-B in that it uses the S1C stage as the first stage, and then the S4B as the upper stage, the second stage. It basically takes out the S2 stage of the Saturn V. But it's not just a Saturn I-B. The Saturn V A derivative is able to be customized depending on a mission. Basically, this rocket could be tailored by only installing the number of F1 engines that were needed for a specific mission or a specific payload. Additionally, the propellant loading in that first stage could be adjusted to achieve the needed thrust-to-weight ratio for that specific mission. So, say you're launching a payload that's between the lift capabilities of the Saturn I-B and the Saturn V. You could put three F1 engines on your Saturn V A derivative and have that perfect launch vehicle for that mission. And all of these customizations were meant to be reversible. So if you start building a Saturn V-A with three F1 engines in that first stage, then your payload gets bigger. You'd be able to very easily add two more F1 engines to make it a Saturn V. The Saturn V-B derivative was also called the S1D. It used a slightly different core stage, and this is a very interesting version. This is a 1.5 stage, basically a single stage to orbit version of the Saturn V rocket. The first stage was the same S1C as the Saturn V used, but with only one engine, the center F1 engine. A half stage would be added around that center stage with four more engines on it. This would effectively separate the inboard engine from the four outboard engines and their supporting structure. So at the moment of launch, all five engines would fire at the same time. At the moment of staging, the four outboard engines on their own separate stage structure would fall away, and that one central F1 engine in the core stage would continue firing until the payload had reached orbit. Of course, to make this happen, that single F1 engine would have to have extended operations compared to a traditional F1 engine on a Saturn V. It would have to fire for 192 seconds longer than a standard S1C stage. And if that S1C stage were elongated to take a larger payload, that central engine would have to fire for an additional 217 seconds. But because it was designed with this one stage that would fall away fairly early on in the flight, it was conceivable that this half stage could be recovered and reused, making this a more cost-effective version of the rocket. The Saturn V C derivative, as the authors envisioned it, would use the same stage and a half to orbit version of the Saturn V, but with an added S4B on top. So you've got a 1.5 stage plus the upper stage. It would also be a more modular rocket. The first stage in this setup would have either 3 or 5 F1 engines, with that center engine reprising its role as the sustainer stage once the outboard engines and their structure fell away. The S4B could have minor adaptations depending on a specific mission. So those are all slightly smaller or slightly larger versions of the Saturn V. With the D derivatives, we get into much larger versions, and it starts to get kind of fun. The idea with the D derivatives was to significantly increase the payload capacity of the Saturn V. The core stage would be the same 33-foot diameter of the standard Saturn V, but it would be extended, not within reasonable limits of the rocket's capability, but within the constraints of the launch facility. The idea was to extend this vehicle in size, not within the confines of what it was needed for a mission, but within the confines of the vehicle assembly building and the existing launch facilities at Kennedy. Remember, the whole point of the Saturn V derivatives was to make better use of all the infrastructure around the Saturn V program. Other versions of the D variation also called for the addition of 2 or 4 external solid rocket motors strapped to the sides, very much like the space shuttle used. The added weight of this hardware and fuel could be offset by increasing the propellant capacity of the main central stage, and upgrading the liquid engines could add more power, making these rocket variations capable of carrying even more mass into orbit. At its largest, D variations of the Saturn V would stand 410 feet tall. That was basically the height limit imposed by the VAB. And from there, the rocket could just keep growing with bigger stages or more external boosters, basically really helping us expand ourselves out into space. The study's author said that all of these derivatives should be studied and worked on at the same time. This would keep production costs down, ultimately lowering the overall cost of the Saturn V. But depending on how many flights a year, it was still an economical decision to extend the program rather than scrap it for something new. But as we know, this did not happen. The final Saturn V flew in 1973 with the launch of Skylab. So what do you guys think of this unrealized future of an extended Saturn V program? Let me know which derivative is your favorite down in the comments below, and of course if you have other questions or comments on the Saturn V rocket and the program as a whole. Be sure to follow me on Twitter and on Instagram for daily vintage space-ish content, and with new videos going up right here every single week, be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode.